and welcome to this edition of the Evening News for today, Tuesday, April 20, 2021. I am Jemima Holmes. Thank you for joining us. Now let's take a look at some of the lead stories tonight. Gaya Oil GM resigns as police question officials amid alleged fuel import racket. GAU aims for a resolution of wage dispute at meeting with Gaisuco on May 4. AG to appeal CJ ruling that appointment of parliamentary secretaries unlawful. Persons urged to abstain from alcohol before and after taking COVID vaccines. And astrotourism could be a successful industry in Guyana, says president of local astronomers club. Now for the news in detail. Some 5 months after he was appointed general manager of the Guyana Oil Company Limited, Trevor Basu has tendered his resignation amid allegations of a major fuel import racket, which is currently being investigated by the police. Our senior political and finance reporter, Gerald Bryan, spoke with Basu, who confirmed his resignation, and chairman of Gaya Oil, Paul Cheung, who explained that the company has a transparent system for sourcing fuel. Here's our lead story tonight.
Sources confirmed that Trevor Basu handed in his resignation as general manager at Gaya Oil. The Evening News also understands that a senior Gaya Oil official has been questioned by the police in relation to the alleged fuel import racket. Today, reports emerged that a businessman alleged that officials at Gaya Oil contracted him to bring in fuel on the promise of kickbacks. The businessman alleged, however, that Gaya Oil got a sweeter deal and subsequently cancelled his arrangement, causing him to speak out. According to the source, the official told police that Basu brought the matter to the company's attention during an executive meeting and implicated him. At the meeting, he said Basu presented evidence of the official's complicity in the form of WhatsApp printouts. According to the official, he denied any role in the alleged racket during When contacted, Gaya Oil chairman Paul Cheung was tight-lipped on the reasons for Basu's resignation. When it comes to the businessman's story, however, Cheung noted that Gaya Oil has a transparent and accountable system for sourcing fuel.
If you have to get the source of the fuel, because there are a lot of places that sell the fuel that they are embargo against. You can't buy fuel from anybody. Right, and all our purchases have gone from most of the state-owned agencies, since I'm chairman, all of the fuel purchases from Castoli or Farias, actually that government-owned company, and Castoli is the government-owned company.
This newscast made contact with Basu himself, who confirmed his resignation but was otherwise tight-lipped. According to him, however, he will be seeking legal advice on the matter. Gerald Bryan, The Evening News.
On the heels of a massive protest by sugar workers in Berbice, the Guyana Sugar Corporation, Gaisuco, has agreed to meet with the Guyana Agricultural and General Workers Union, GAU, on May 4 to discuss the ongoing wage and salary dispute. In this Rupesi Narain report, GAU President C. Paul Narain says the union is optimistic that the issue would be resolved at the upcoming engagement.
This week, over 5,000 workers from the Blairmont and Albion estates in Barbies protested for promised increases by Gaisuco for the year 2019. President of GAU, C. Paul Narain, told the Evening News earlier today that Gaisuco has since requested a meeting on May 4th, where the negotiations on wage increase will continue. According to Narain, the union remains hopeful that the dispute will be settled. For now, workers have returned to their daily operation.
Well, I believe that the CEO has the authority to get it resolved. So we are very hopeful that the matter could be resolved and would be resolved. So they want to have a resolve like we want to do. And Gaisuco, we are hopeful that when we meet on the 4th of May, we will have a resolve of the issue.
Since 2018, the workers have been pushing for the corporation by the way of strikes for wage and salary increases. They have not received any since 2014. However, in 2020, the corporation agreed to pay a 5% across-the-board increase with the promise that they would also pay retroactive increases for 2019. The 5% increase for 2020 was open for further discussion. Rupa Sinarayan, The Evening News.
Shadow Home Affairs Minister Geeta Chandan Edmund has submitted to the National Assembly a plethora of questions regarding the operations of the new Corporate Communications Unit of the Guyana Police Force. Here are the details from Lakram Bagirat.
On February 16, 2021, radio broadcaster Stan Govaya announced that he was appointed Deputy Communications Director of the Guyana Police Force, while former Editor-in-Chief of the state-owned Guyana Chronicle, Mark Ramotar, became the Director. Govaya and Ramotar assumed their new roles effective February 1. This arrangement is a deviation from standard practice whereby a serving member of the force would assume responsibility for the organization's public relations. Geeta Chandan Edmund, who represents the APNUFC opposition, has asked Home Affairs Minister Robeson Benn to explain the rationale of setting up a new unit to manage the force's communication and public relations. Minister Benn was also asked to disclose whether the positions of director and deputy director were advertised and what criteria was used in arriving at the suitable candidates. Chandan Edmund further requested that copies of the terms of the contracts for the appointments of director and deputy director of the Corporate Communications Unit be made public. The opposition member also asked the Home Affairs Minister to disclose their qualifications, duties and responsibilities and state if other allowances and benefits are afforded to the director and deputy director which are not included in their contracts. She also wanted the minister to state whether the roles of these new employees overlap those of police officers who have been trained and assigned to perform these tasks. Moreover, Chandan Edmund inquired whether other civilians are attached to the unit. She also asked whether police officers operate within the unit, and if yes, for the minister to disclose how many. Minister Benn is expected to make his answer available in writing at the next sitting of the National Assembly. Reporting for The Evening News, Lakram Bagirat.
Newly elected Chairman of the Local Government Commission, Julius Faber, has assured that the organization is committed to providing quality service to the public. Ebony Giles tells us more.
Julius Faber, who's the former chairman of Region 3, has been elected to serve as the chairman of the Local Government Commission. Faber, in an interview with the state media, said that the commission will be working with the respective bodies to provide quality service to the population.
I want to assure the public that we will ensure that the services these bodies provide, the local bodies provide, will be of a high quality, and so the end users of those services must be satisfied with the performance of those local NDCs, town council.
He added that the commission will also be working on revolutionizing the neighborhood democratic councils along with municipalities to make this possible.
We at the commission's level are going to ensure that training is provided for the staff in those local bodies so that they in turn will ensure that they have the requisite knowledge and expertise to provide the services required in those communities.
Meanwhile, the deputy chairman, Mr. Norman Whitaker, said that the commission will mirror the president's approach of involving the beneficiaries in decision-making.
In a lot of these NDCs and municipalities, we do not think that councillors and staff are reaching out to the people who are the beneficiaries of the services and who would like their contribution to be felt and to be meaningful. And we do not think that in the local, many of the local authorities, enough of that is being done, reaching out to the people. Let them know what you plan. In fact, involve them in the planning of what will be done. And involve them also in the various activities.
Reporting for The Evening News, Ebony Giles.
The Tushaw of Chinese Landing in Region 1, Barima Waini, has been robbed of a boat and engine worth $4.5 million between Sunday and Monday last. Erin Fernandez was robbed sometime between 18 hours on Sunday and 5 hours on Monday at Chinese Landing in the Northwest District. According to police, based on information received, Fernandez secured his boat and a 200 HP Yamaha outboard engine at the back of his home, which is just about 100 feet from the creek. However, on Monday morning, he observed the boat and engine were missing. He made several checks in and around Chinese Landing, but came up empty-handed. However, information the Tushaw received from persons in the area stated that a suspect, whom they named, cut the boat's rope. They claim that the suspect was seen heading towards the Waini River with the boat. As such, the Tushaw made a report via cellular phone to the Aquero Police Station. An investigation has been launched. Coming up, AG to appeal CJ ruling that appointment of parliamentary secretaries unlawful, and government retenders for construction of Health Ministry's headquarters. Do stay with us.
Your number one supermarket, Cost Cutter, has everything you need. Come down to our Sheriff Street or our Track A Farm East Bank Demerara location and shop in comfort, knowing that you're also getting the most competitive prices. We currently have specials on onions, £5 for $500 or a 50-pound bag for $3,500. Purple onions, 25-pound bag for $22.50. Happy macaroni, 400-gram packet, one for $200 and three for $500. Just juice, 500 milliliter, one for $135 and get four for $500. Miran soybean oil 500 milliliter bottle, one for $275, four for $1,000. Aqua Pure water 24 330 milliliter bottles, $1,100 per case. Buy 10 cases and get one case free, and much more. Give us a call on 231-7180 or 502-5660. You can also WhatsApp our farm branch on 686-6501 and our Sheriff Street branch on 686-7536.
The cheese, you hear the crunch. Think about zoomers and zoom into fun. And with the first taste, you feel like you don't want it done. Blast off to a whole new place with every single bite. The cheesy goodness bring your taste buds alive. So let's just zoom into fun with this wheel-shaped light.
Visit Gafur's Tiles and Sanitary Ware Department for stunning designs and the best in wall and floor tiles for your kitchen, bathroom, outdoor, steps, living room, and more. The Tile Department also provides products to clean, polish, and protect your tiles. Tile trims to give your tile area a complete look. Tint sets for both porcelain and ceramic tiles, along with a variety of grout colors. Not forgetting tile paste to lay tiles on wood, concrete surfaces. Our line of products combine the ideal blend of style and innovation and meet the needs of every customer. We stock a vast variety of kitchen sinks, basins and faucets, toilets in a variety of colors and designs, along with every accessory to accentuate. Stylish double-mirrored bathroom cabinets, clear and frosted bathroom doors and enclosures. Remember, for superior customer services, superior quality and competitive prices, it's Gafur's. The name you can trust.
John Lewis Styles introduces its VIP Rewards Card. Apply today and get special discounts on clothing, shoes, and accessories. Shop and save on your favorite brands by just showing your card. No points to accumulate or bills to keep. It's that simple. Apply today for your John Lewis Styles VIP Rewards Card. See store for more details. John Lewis Styles, simply different.
Masi is by your side as we continue the fight against the COVID-19 pandemic. In collaboration with OneCart, you can now get your groceries delivered or you can pick up curbside. Call, email or WhatsApp your order to us. This service is available at both Providence and Turkine locations. Delivery and pickup between 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. The fee is based on location. Orders must be paid in cash and placed 24 hours in advance. Special conditions apply. Remember to always protect yourself and those around you by wearing your masks. Also, don't forget to wash your hands and maintain a distance of 6 feet at all times around persons. Massey Stores, our family serves.
Welcome back. You're watching the evening news. Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs Anil Nanglao will be appealing a decision handed down today by Chief Justice Roxanne George that the appointment of two parliamentary secretaries in September 2020 was unlawful. Gerald Bryan reports.
Chief Justice Roxanne George handed down a ruling this afternoon in a virtual court session. According to her ruling, the appointments of Vikash Ramkissoon and Sarah Brown as parliamentary secretaries were unlawful and they cannot be considered lawful members of the National Assembly. The Chief Justice cited Articles 113, 186, and 1033 of the Constitution in arriving at her decision. She had said that the lower court was bound by the 2016 decision of the Court of Appeal in the matter of Attorney General versus Morion. However, the Chief Justice stopped short of granting the coercive orders initially sought by applicant Christopher Jones. This means that the enforcement of her judgment within the walls of Parliament will be in the hands of Speaker of the National Assembly Mansoor Nadir. Attorney General Anil Nandalal has meanwhile indicated his intent to appeal the ruling. According to the notice of appeal seen by this newscast, the AG will be seeking to have the Chief Justice's ruling set aside and for costs to be awarded. His grounds include arguments that the Chief Justice misdirected herself in the law. Gerald Bryan, The Evening News.
For some 3 years now, the Neighborhood Democratic Council in East Kanji, Berbice, has been unable to offer garbage disposal services to residents who are up in arms over the situation. Our Berbice correspondent Andrew Carmichael reports.
The Canefield Enterprise NDC has a tractor and trailer for garbage collection, but according to the chairwoman, the council does not have the capacity to dispose of solid waste. According to Sherianne Bihari, there is no dump site in the area.
See, we wrote since 2018 and we didn't have any response to have the dump site to give to us. That was at by the Gangaram term when you go. We did not have approval for that, so we had to use this private company, Sevens Waste Management, because that's the only way we could eliminate all the garbage that we see. But residents need to buy into it because they're still dumping and we got to be coming out and cleaning it up.
When the evening news visited the community on Saturday, items which persons had no use of, including food boxes, drink bottles and other disposable containers, were being disposed of on the road shoulders. Some have been taking their unwanted material and disposing of it in nearby canals. On Saturday, councillors and NDC staff were involved in a cleanup campaign in the community.
We're doing a cleanup campaign to send awareness to the resident not to dump garbage, because there is a private garbage collection that we're using within the NDC, is Sevens Waste Management, and we're asking the resident to use that facility to help us eliminate all the garbage, because it is health we're looking for in the with the resident within our area.
This newscast understands that 2/3 of the NDC's revenue is paid by the sugar corporation, Gaisuko. However, over the past few years, they have not been paying their taxes to the NDC. According to the chairwoman, some residents pay as little as $200 property tax per year, which she said is totally inadequate and cannot provide the services required. Nevertheless, efforts are still being made to ensure that residents play their part in ensuring the community is clean.
When you clean it and you pick it up, what do you do with it?
We took it to the dump site in Yamsan for now, because we don't have that facility to dump it to.
So So can't you also collect their garbage and take it to New Amsterdam?
It's more expensive when it comes to picking up, because remember, we have to use a lot of fuel. We only have one tractor and trailer, so, and then we don't have the manpower. We're short even of manpower, the NDC, when it comes to the SIP team workers then, because right now we are using SIP workers, we're using the NDC overseer and staff and all the counselors.
Andrew Carmichael for Evening News.
The government of Guyana has retendered for the contract to construct the Ministry of Health headquarters at Brickdam, one of several troubled contracts that the People's Progressive Party Civic had to terminate over breaches by the contractor. Details in this report.
According to a published notice, phase one of the project will be retendered and bids will be opened on May 4, 2021, as per the Procurement Act of 2003. A notice further informed that bidding documents can be purchased from April 9. The notice further explained, quote, a pre-bid conference will be held on April 22, 2021 at the Ministry of Health's Permanent Secretary Boardroom, Lot 1, Brickdam. Bids will be opened in the presence of bidding representatives and anyone who chooses to attend on May 4th, end quote. After repeated contractual breaches, protracted delays and almost tripling of the contract costs, the government had in November 2020 terminated the $356.8 million contract that was awarded to Chung's Global Enterprise to construct the headquarters of the Health Ministry. In a letter, Attorney General Anil Nandlal had written to Cleon Chung of Chung's Global Enterprise, had informed him that the contract was being terminated effective October 31, 2020, on the grounds of contractual breaches. Chung's was awarded the contract in 2017 to construct the Public Health Ministry's head office building at Lot 1 Brickdam to the tune of $356.8 million. Works commenced on July 19, 2018, and the contractor was supposed to complete the project within a year. However, in September 2020, despite receiving $308.4 million for advance payments and mobilization expenses, as well as two extensions totaling 317 days, permanent works were 70% completed at the site. To add insult to injury, the contractor submitted a repriced bill of quantities demanding an additional sum of $513.3 million on August 3, 2020, a mere day after the government officially changed hands with the swearing-in of President Dr. Irfan Ali. The new bill of quantities submitted by the contractor contained a breakdown of all completed works and their corresponding costs, as well as a breakdown of the outstanding works to be completed and their estimated cost. Auditor General Deodat Sharma himself had previously flagged the delay state of the project under the nose of the former A Partnership for National Unity Alliance for Change government. In the 2017 audit report, it was pointed out that the project was at a standstill during an August site visit. By this time, the contractor had already collected $71.3 million in advanced payments. Reporting for the Evening News, Lake Rambagirat.
While there is no solid scientific evidence to support the theory that COVID-19 vaccines will react adversely with alcohol, Health Minister Dr. Frank Anthony is urging persons to abstain from alcoholic beverages during the period of taking their first and second jabs. Rupa Sinarine tells us more.
During the latest COVID-19 update, Health Minister Dr. Frank Anthony advised persons not to consume alcohol before and after taking the vaccine. This is in order to document any possible symptoms properly. In that same breath, he debunked an article which claimed that persons must abstain from alcohol for 2 months post-immunization, stating that there is no evidence in the scientific literature to support this.
Like with all vaccines, we would prefer people not to drink before they come for a vaccine, and immediately after to abstain. And the reason being is that if we are going to observe to see whether or not someone has side effects from the vaccine, then we need that person to be sober. So we haven't seen in any of the scientific literature that the vaccine interacts in any adverse way with alcohol.
Speaking on the pandemic locally, the minister pointed to regions 3, 4, and 7, where pockets of cases have been identified. Several villages have also seen a few positives.
We have seen an increase in cases in region 4, region 3. We have also, in region 7, we have a number of cases as well. So we continue to monitor these areas. In region 4 specifically, we have seen an upsurge in cases around Diamond Eccles area. On the East Coast, we have seen cases in the Lusignan Success area. So there are pockets where we are seeing more cases, but generally when we look across, say, the East Coast or Georgetown or the East Bank, almost every village, there are one or two cases.
Due to the spike in cases within recent weeks, the minister said health teams have continued monitoring. There are also a number of patients under isolation.
We have to keep monitoring. We have a number of persons in home isolation and we have a number of persons in institutional isolation, and that exercise continues. But again, it comes back to people doing the right public health measures, and that is wearing their mask, making sure that they keep the distancing. And once you do that, at least you're protecting yourself, and by extension, you're protecting your family when you get back home. So once you're out in the public, you have to take these precautions because you don't know who you might be sitting next to or standing next to, whether they have the virus or not.
At the Infectious Diseases Hospital at Liliendal, there are 71 patients under hospitalization, while another 15 are at the West Demerara Regional Hospital. An additional 5 is at the New Amsterdam facility. Rupa Sinarain, The Evening News.
Two more persons who were infected with the novel coronavirus have died, raising the death toll to 273. They are both men, ages 60 and 56, from Region 6 and 10, respectively. There are 71 new cases of the virus in the country, with a total of 11,972 positive cases recorded to date. 13 persons are in the ICU, while 73 are in institutional isolation, 1,315 in home isolation, and 11 in institutional quarantine. A total of 10,297 persons have recovered. Guyana's prime geographical position near the equator, coupled with its low light pollution, makes the country an ideal destination for astrotourism, an activity in which stargazers from around the world can gather to observe the celestial activities in the mysterious night sky. Here is Ebony Giles with this story.
This point was underscored by local astrophotographer Ferlin Pedro, who's the founder of the Amateur Astronomers Association of Guyana, which was established in 2015 to promote astronomy among Guyanese. During a recent panel discussion on astronomy in the Caribbean, which was hosted by Marie House, Pedro was asked about the possibility of Guyana adding astrotourism to its international tourism portfolio. Pedro admitted that he did have discussions with various tourism groups on the matter, but he cautioned that stargazers are a minority population. He agreed that the concept of astrotourism would be perfect for the country, especially since developed countries have immense light population, whereas Guyana offers many destinations for stargazing.
Stargazers are a minority group. So if we want to preserve the night sky, we're going to have to talk about it and openly in the public. I've done my fair share on that. I've written letters to the newspapers on that specific issue. I've also discussed it with the certain tourism groups that are promoting Guyana. And I've introduced this concept of astrotourism, which is, you know, I mean, it makes sense, right? Like you described, we have wonderful dark skies. And people from, you know, what we call the developed world, at least abroad internationally, as they're, you know, they're very like polluted, and they get away to go far away, far distances, and take their own telescopes and photography equipment to take snaps of gorgeous dark skies. So it is a real industry. And so it's an industry that we can tap into. But more to the matter, it is political by nature. We're going to have to press it openly and publicly. So I would encourage you to add your voice. Feel free to add your voice. Just write a letter to the newspaper, write a letter to the minister responsible, parliament, you name it. Let's get the discussion rolling.
Mahendra Mahadeo, a Guyanese who hails from the east coast of Demerara, explained how his hobby in astronomy turned into a promising career. During the panel discussion, he shared how growing up in Guyana, resources and knowledge about astronomy were very limited. In fact, they still are. This was not going to stop Mahadeo from pursuing his passion, and at the age of 24, he built his own telescope. In fact, he admitted that to date, he has never really purchased a telescope, he just continues to build his own. Today, his hobby has turned into a career, as he is now working with Teleview, a New York-based company known primarily for its premium brand of specialty eyepieces and refracture telescopes.
In Guyana, I was an engineer working in the heavy machinery industry. So I had a job that made me money, and then I used that money to pursue my hobby. You know, I didn't expect to make a living out of my hobby. And then when I came to the United States and I finished my master's degree, as luck would have it, a friend of mine knew the president of Teleview Optics. And he told the president of Teleview Optics, David Nagler, that he knows this guy, he's graduating, you know, he's built his own telescope before and that kind of thing. And that's how I was able to get a job in the optical field.
Mahadeo's raw talent left president of the Barbados Astronomical Society, David Marshall, in complete awe. Marshall, who is an amateur astronomer, noted that there is great opportunity for regional collaboration in the area of astronomy in the Caribbean. For example, he explained, if there is a noteworthy celestial event occurring within the region, there can be joint efforts to provide coverage. Another example, he said, is Mahadeo's skill and knowledge in building his own telescope, which can be shared among other persons who are interested in the science but are unable to see through a telescope. Meanwhile, Dr. Sharon Hawk, who hails from Trinidad and Tobago, also explained that as a child, she was always told that astronomy is not possible in the Caribbean. But today, she's a professional astronomer working right in her home country. She has undertaken extensive astronomy research right within the Caribbean. For instance, she noted that OJ-287, a BL LAK object located 3.5 billion light years away, is observed from St. Augustine. She noted too that a team from Trinidad was a part of the historic Rosetta mission, which landed a probe on a comet. Another exciting aspect of astronomy is astrobiology. In Trinidad, Dr. Hawk would study the mud volcanoes and the pitch lake to try to understand if there can be any sense of life elsewhere in the solar system where these elements are naturally formed, like on Mars and Saturn's largest moon, Titan.
We can be small. It doesn't mean that we are invisible. You can be here with next to no funding, but we can make magic happen.
Reporting for the Evening News, Ebony Giles.
Now let's take a look at the bridge reports.
The Demerara Harbor Bridge is scheduled to be closed on Wednesday, April 21st, 2021, at 1 hour and then again at 11 hours for a period of 1.5 hour each. Meanwhile, the Burbies River Bridge is scheduled to be closed on Wednesday, April 21st, 2021, at 10 hours 50 for a period of 1.5 hour.
Now let's take a look at the local stock exchange market, compliments of Gassi. Dawan, Mishra lead Delhi Capitals to comprehensive win over Mumbai Indians and South American Senior Championships a worry for AAG. Details of these stories and more in the Sportcast, sponsored by MacCorp, coming up on the other side of the break.
Looking to bring your dream home to reality or simply taking on a home improvement project? Then National Hardware Limited is where you should start. Let us put that touch to your home. Choose from over 1,000 Berger Paint original hues for any surface. We are known for our trusted brands such as Westinghouse, Philips, Satco, Rubbermaid, Pyrex, Gibson Home, and so much more. National Hardware Limited, your do-it-best store, located in downtown Georgetown and industrial site Rheinwald.
Planning a cleanup? We can help. Sivan's Waste Management skip bins can be provided for home renovation projects, yard cleanups, or construction sites. It's simple. Step one, just pick up the phone and give us a call. Step two, we deliver the skip bin size of your choice. Step three, load the skip with all of your junk. And finally, step four, we take it all away. It's that simple. Bins are also available in various sizes, so there's no job that's too big or too small. Call Sivan's Waste Management today at 218-1455 or 218-11.
Poultry farmers, save money by cutting down the time it takes to pluck your chickens with a plucking machine from Silvey's. Now available at affordable prices. In three sizes, 500, 550 and 600 mm, 110, 220 volts, 60 cycles, 1450 RPM. Replacement motors and the plucking fingers are also readily available right now at Sylvie's Variety Store, High and Hatfield Streets, George.
Welcome back to this evening's sportcast, sponsored by MACORP.